Hi, I'm Rick from Linear Research, and in this video, I'm going to give you a very brief introduction to Linear Research, the company, and then we'll focus our attention on our M&C series of high-performance networked DSP amplifiers. Linear Research was founded back in 2003 by a group of engineers with a long history in professional audio. Between them, they developed some of our industry's most recognized products, from DSP processors and matrix products to power amplifiers and mixing consoles. We began exclusively as an OEM provider, manufacturing loudspeaker processors like our LSC26 and amplifier modules like our much acclaimed Minipod, XPod and XPod HP. Many of the industry's leading brands partnered with Linear Research as their electronics providers. Here you can see just a few of those we've worked with over the years. It wasn't until the spring of 2016, however, that Linear Research products became fully available under the Linear Research brand name with the introduction of our 44 M20 power amplifier. This groundbreaking amplifier was quickly recognized as a turning point in amplifier technology, providing class-leading sound quality coupled with sustained power delivery. Since then, this has developed into a wide range of products, as you can see here, from our ASC48 Advanced System Controller to our M and C series of multi-channel amplifiers. And it's these amplifiers that we're going to focus on in this video. Both M and C series amplifiers use the same internal technology, but are tailored to different applications. The M series is focused at mobile users, while the C series has been developed with contractors and installations in mind. M and C series amplifiers all come with analog and AES inputs as standard, plus an optional dual redundant Dante interface, 96 kHz DSP with FIR filters available on every output, Ethernet control, third-party control for systems like Symmetrix and others, and many more features that we'll discuss in more detail shortly. Before we dig into the details, first of all, I'd like to explain our naming convention. Once you understand this, all of the model numbers become immediately clear. If we look at our 44M20, for example, the first character is the number of input channels, the second, the number of outputs. Next, there's M or C, which as I mentioned means mobile or contractor. Finally, you have the power rating in kilowatts. The 44M20 is a 4-in, 4-out, 20 kilowatt amplifier, while the 88C06 is an 8-in, 8-out contractor or installation amplifier with a total of 6 kilowatts or 750 watts per channel. Okay, so now we've got that, here's the product lineup for 4-channel amplifiers. Remember, both the M and the C have the same basic internals and power ratings. At the top here, you can see the 44M20 and 44C20, each delivering 4 channels at 5 kilowatts per channel into 2 ohm loads, decreasing to 4 channels of 3 kilowatts at 4 ohm loads and 4 by 1500 watts at 8 ohm loads. This same amplifier is also 70 or 100 volt capable, delivering up to 3500 watts per channel, and it's bridgeable. Next we have our 10K or 4 by 2500 watt amplifier, then our 6K or 4 by 1500 watt amplifier, and if you look at the power by load impedance, you'll see here that in this amplifier we can deliver that same 1500 watts into any load from 2 ohms to 8 ohms or 70 volt or 100 volt. And again, all of these are bridgeable. In the 8-channel configuration, first, it's important to note that the mobile series amps have 4 inputs and 8 outputs, while the contractor C-series amplifiers have 8 in and 8 out. Here, you can see our largest 8-channel amplifier, the 48M or 88C20, which can deliver up to 20 kilowatts or 8 channels of 2500 watts per channel at 4 ohms. Next, there's the 48 or 88 10 kilowatt models with 1250 watts per channel, the 6 kilowatt version at 750 watts per channel, and finally the 3 kilowatt or actually 3200 watt models at 8 by 400 per channel. Again, all of these are fully 70 or 100 volt compatible, selectable channel by channel, and they can be bridged. Now, when it comes to amplifier specifications, unfortunately, it seems no two manufacturers use the same method for presenting their data. Terms like burst power are common, as are many asterisked disclaimers. Basically, when we say we can deliver 4 channels of 5 kilowatts per channel, this is not a burst power spec. This is the RMS power that we can deliver with all 4 channels driven, and we can deliver it on a sustained basis for a second or more at a time. That compares to others who are quoting burst power of 8 or 25 milliseconds. Here's an excerpt from one of our data sheets showing some of the additional details that we provide. We don't just provide the headline marketing power rating, but we also break this down by crest factor or signal density, which gives you more information to make decisions from. We're going to come back to these power ratings a little later, but I'd like to move on to discuss some of the other features of the amplifiers. As I said earlier, all of our M and C series amplifiers are fully Ethernet networkable, share the same powerful DSP architecture, and they're all available with dual redundant Dante options. When it comes to the DSP, as you might expect given the company's heritage, we're doing everything we can to give you the best audio quality. So we start with premium 96 kHz oversampling A to D converters and excellent input signal conditioning, and then we use a Shark DSP chip with custom linear research algorithms. We run our DSPs at 96 kHz, which gives us another sonic advantage, and we use some proprietary techniques to ensure we maximize dynamic range and fidelity. We actually have a design philosophy that we call micro detail, and this governs everything from how we lay out a trace on a circuit board to how we manage quantization noise in the DSP. In the DSP, you'll find the normal loudspeaker processing elements like EQ, crossover, delay and gain, plus a few enhanced features. We're actually going to look at this in more detail, and we're going to use a sneak preview of our System Engineer 8 control software to do this. And we'll start by looking at crossovers. Here you can see that we offer you the typical Bessel, Butterworth and Linkwitz-Riley selections, but we also have an additional LIR type crossover filter. This is a low latency linear phase type of crossover filter. If you're interested in more information on this, we have a white paper on our website. In the crossover module, this is also where you're going to find our limiter setup. And we have 3 different stages of limiter available in our VX limiter suite. First of all, there's our VX limiter. This is the heart of our limiting and protection systems. VX stands for virtual crossover, and it has 2 modes of operation. In its simplest, normal mode, it operates similar to a conventional limiter. It's pseudo peak sensing calibrated in RMS voltage. In contrast to a conventional limiter, however, it operates as a multi-band limiter, managing different parts of the spectrum independently. Not only does this provide excellent protection, but it also allows each band to use its own optimized attack and release characteristics, giving a more natural and transparent sound under limiting. In addition to the threshold control, we also give you an overshoot control, which is basically a brick wall hard limiter above the standard limiter, allowing you a more natural control of the dynamics. With VX mode engaged, you get to choose a virtual crossover point for the limiter, effectively separating the high and low frequency content so each can be limited individually, even though it's still a full range output. This is especially useful when dealing with passively crossed over loudspeakers, allowing the high frequency content to breathe regardless of low frequency content, minimizing pumping of, say, vocal intelligibility by a kick drum beat. Next, we have our thermal or Tmax limiter, which is designed to protect against overheating the voice coil. This would normally be set around the RMS voltage spec for the driver in question, and you can also set the attack and release times to suit. Finally, there's the excursion or Xmax limiter, which works to protect the driver against excessive linear movement, which could cause damage. Setting this up requires detailed knowledge of the speaker's excursion and frequency characteristics. There's more detail available on our limiter suite in a white paper you can find on our website. Now let's have a look at our EQ section. For each input or processing block, we have a high pass filter, 2 low frequency shelves, 6 bands of parametric EQ, plus a high shelving filter. This high shelf also has an FIR mode, which will ensure flat phase response when it's used across adjacent bands. Each output has high and low shelving filters, plus 8 bands of parametric EQ. And any of these filters can be used as a variable Q bandpass filter to adjust phase response. We also offer user-importable FIR filters on every output channel, and these can be used at the same time as the traditional EQ you see here. Once you've created your DSP settings, you can store them as presets. Our presets allow you to define individual component setting, loudspeaker or drive module setting, and finally complete amplifier snapshots. Now, this certainly isn't a complete list of our features. There's many more features to discuss, but they're really outside the scope of this introduction. So now that we've covered the basic feature set, I'd like to revisit our power ratings. And we're actually going to do that by talking about how an amplifier works. When you consider a power amplifier's job, it takes small volts, music, speech, and movie, and turns them into big volts to drive loudspeakers. And it does this by using electrical power from the mains. So we take the power in, charge up some capacitors, dump that power into a load, charge up the caps again, dump that power into a load, rinse and repeat. The crucial point here is the size of the power supply and the energy that can be stored inside the amplifier. In our case, we use an oversized power supply. So for example, our 20 kilowatt amplifier has a power supply capacity of 24 kilowatts. We also use a very large bank of capacitors in the center of the amplifier between the power supply stage and the output stage, and this gives us considerable energy storage. Now, let's take a look at heat. While it's doing its job, the amplifier is going to heat up. And this heat is wasted energy. And the measure of how much energy is wasted is its efficiency. So for a given output power, an efficient amplifier design will generate less heat than a less efficient design. And this means less of the energy being stored is being wasted. In a linear research amplifier, we actually benefit on both sides of this equation, both by having a lot of capacitors, which equates to a lot of energy storage, and we have excellent efficiency, so less of the energy is being wasted, which means we can keep the caps charged up better while the amplifier is under load. Now, this graph shows you the efficiency of a Linear Research 44M20 amplifier compared against two competing amplifiers. You can see how the Linear Research amplifier is considerably more efficient than either one of these competing amps. And I should mention at this point that this data and the rest of the comparison data I'm going to show you is from a fully independent source. And these aren't cheap competing amplifiers. These are competitors' flagship touring products. So the third thing I want to look at is cooling. Now, while our amplifier is very efficient, at the end of the day, this is still a 20 kilowatt amplifier. And so it's still going to generate heat. Now, if we're generating heat, we have to have a way to get that heat out. And if we can't get that heat out, then we have to throttle or attenuate or turn down the amplifier to keep it within its safe operating zone. So we use extremely efficient fans coupled with computer modeled and designed heat sinks to manage the airflow through the amplifier and keep it cool. It's this interrelationship of power storage, heat and efficiency, and finally cooling that sets our amplifiers apart. We can only draw so much power from the mains, so we waste less of it, we store more of it, and what heat we do generate, we get out quickly. All of this allows us to deliver more power for longer without having to introduce attenuation. This allows us to support sustained bass signals, for example, and denser program material. Here's those same three amplifiers we looked at earlier. This time we're comparing them using different signal stimulus. Let's start off by looking at the manufacturer's spec sheet ratings. You can see here, they're all quite similar. In fact, they're all doing about 5 kilowatts into 2 ohms. Next, let's compare the measured performance using an industry standard EIA 60 second signal source. This is a bursty noise source that's designed to simulate a music signal. Again, you can see they're all somewhat in the ballpark of what they say they're going to do. Now we're going to look at an 8 millisecond sine wave burst. Now this presents a greater challenge to the amplifiers and is more indicative of a dense program material. Finally, we're going to look at a simple 1 kHz sine wave for 1 second, and most amplifiers don't like dealing with sine waves because it's constant power. You can see here that the Linear Research amplifier is giving more than twice, in fact almost 3 times the power of the competing amplifiers. Under this sine wave condition, we're able to hold little over 2 kilowatts, while the other amplifiers are 675 to 800 watts. And that's when driven with a simple sine wave. So, we've covered an awful lot of ground here, and we've really just scratched the surface. But hopefully we've given you a little more insight into Linear Research, some of our products, our approach to amplification and DSP, and what we think sets us apart from some of the other products on the market. If you'd like more information, then please do get in touch. You can find our contact info and that for your local distributor or sales rep all on our website. Thank you very much for watching.